Congressman James Comer joins us to talk for the first time since January 6th. Congressman, thanks for waking up and making time for us.
Thanks for having me on.
Well, Congressman, we want to start our interview this morning by like we said, we haven't spoken to you since January 6th. Can you take us through what happened that morning and afternoon at the Capitol? You were on the House floor whenever kind of that chaos really started to hit inside the Capitol building.
Well, it was surreal. It was definitely a dark day in the history of America, but I was sitting on the House floor listening to the debate, and Pelosi was presiding over the House, which she doesn't do very often. And I looked up and noticed that the security had asked her to leave, and they took her out. And I really didn't think much about it. We knew people were protesting outside, but we had no idea they had already breached the Capitol building. And then a few minutes later, security came in and got leadership out. Steny Hoyer on the Democrat side and Steve Scalise on our side. And at that time, people were going around saying, everybody be calm. And everybody was calm. Everybody was sitting there. A few minutes after that, they stopped the debate. And about that time, the Capitol Police retreated into the House chambers and locked the door and started barricading the door. And at that point, you knew something was really bad wrong. And then we could start hearing people beating on the doors, trying to get in. And that's when they evacuated the house, and we were evacuated to a couple of spots around the Capitol complex in the building, and then over in the Rayburn office building. We finally ended up in the Longworth building once the SWAT team got there and secured a place for the around 75 members of the House who were actually on the floor at the time of the intrusion.
And you condemned the violence that day, but you did vote to not impeach the president. Does the president bear some responsibility for what happened and what you went through that day?
I think everyone in politics and the media bear some responsibility. The rhetoric has been at the maximum volume for over a year now. People on both sides of the spectrum are angry at their government. They're angry at the process. And I think that, you know, there's no one person in particular that bears the blame. I've said this many times. The president at the time of the vote only had 1 week remaining in his term. I didn't see any point in impeachment with 1 week remaining. And besides, he hasn't had an opportunity to defend himself. There were no committee hearings. He hasn't had due process. He hasn't even hired a legal team. So I believe that more than anything, it was a political stunt by Nancy Pelosi that only further divides America.
Now, some people watching this here in your district, Congressman, don't believe that President-elect Joe Biden was elected fairly. Some watching right now don't believe that he's going to be inaugurated Wednesday at noon. What are your thoughts on the inauguration?
Well, you know, everything that I see, he's going to be inaugurated. You know, a lot of us were disappointed in the outcome of the presidential election. I certainly was a strong Donald Trump supporter, and he won my district by almost 50 points. So he's very popular in this area. But when you have an opportunity to look back at what happened, the states, we believe in the 10th Amendment as conservatives. So we believe in states' rights. The states make their own election rules for better or worse. I don't want California coming in telling Kentucky how to do their election rules, and I'm sure California feels the same about Kentucky. And then the states made their own election rules. The state legislatures and the state boards of elections certified the results in all those states. I do believe there were irregularities, especially with absentee voting. But when the state legislatures didn't step up, when the state boards of elections certified all 50 states, and when 62 lawsuits that the president had were all rejected by the courts, including the Supreme Court, where the president has appointed a third of the membership, you know, there wasn't anything left. And the outcome is Biden becoming president.
And so we're looking forward ahead now to President-elect Biden becoming the president on Wednesday, and then starts the new Congress and the new administration. What are you working on, or what are you hopeful for will happen as far as uniting the country and maybe getting something done in Congress?
Well, we're going to have to look at areas where we can agree. Even though the Democrats have the majority in the House, it's a slim majority. The Senate is a 50-50 tie. The the Democrats aren't going to have the spread to pass a real liberal radical agenda. So they're going to have to compromise. They're going to have to work with Republicans. And when you look at the areas where there is potential for agreement, certainly infrastructure is an area where we can agree on. I think we've got to invest in rebuilding America, roads, bridges, rural broadband, along the river system there, the locks and dams. So there's plenty of infrastructure needs to go around. And I think that's an area where we can start. It's also an area that will stimulate the economy instead of Biden's liberal Christmas wish list of reducing or eliminating student loan debt and starting all these new social program giveaways. Let's focus on spending money on things that we need in America and things that will help create jobs. I think infrastructure is a great place to start.
Congressman, would you agree that the vaccine rollout that we're currently seeing, we're seeing issues with that? Do you think anything will change with the new administration? Do you think maybe more can be done here in the state of Kentucky to improve the vaccine rollout and what we've seen over the last few weeks?
Well, I think the Trump administration deserves a lot of credit. We never dreamed that the vaccine would be available before the end of January. So we've already got a month's head start. So there are a lot of people that have already been vaccinated that no one would have dreamed would have been vaccinated at this point. When you're talking about giving two shots to every American, that's a logistics nightmare, especially when you have to refrigerate the vaccines at such low temperatures. So I think from a logistical standpoint, it's been a challenge, but I believe that we're ahead of schedule and hopefully all the frontline healthcare workers have just about had an opportunity to be vaccinated, and hopefully they're in there getting all the at-risk people in the nursing homes and places like that. I know not everyone has gotten that yet. That's why I have not taken the vaccine yet. I don't want to take it until all the people who need it more than I do get it first. So we're still working on trying to get it into all the nursing homes and hospitals, but I think that it's going to happen. I think we're ahead of schedule, and hopefully we can get that finished by the end of spring, first of summer.
Congressman Comer, thanks for making time for us here on this Monday morning.
My pleasure.